today on Christian World News, our best stories of 2012, including the shakeup in the Middle East and how the revolution in Egypt is affecting that country's 2,000-year-old Christian community. Plus, in Nigeria, the prayer campaign that's pushing back against the deadly terrorist group waging war on the church. And our visit with Gracia Burnham, 10 years after the rescue that freed her from Muslim rebels and took her husband's life. Welcome to our year in review edition of Christian World News. I'm Wendy Griffith. Well, major changes swept Egypt this year. Elections brought the Muslim Brotherhood and other Islamist groups into power in the legislature and the presidency. Now, thousands of Christians are fleeing that country. However, as this wave of unprecedented emigration grows, Gary Lane reports that the Egyptian church may be on the verge of an awakening.
Egypt is becoming more polarized as Islamists try to impose their beliefs on the society.
You have here an emboldened local Islamist, emboldened with the idea that one of their brethren is in power, to basically implement what they see as the rightful law or God's message on the ground without even the need of a government.
The creeping Islamization has Egypt's minority Coptic Christian community nervous. Many have already left the country, and more are expected to follow.
It's an exodus of biblical proportions just over the last 12 months.
Lord David Alton is with the human rights group Jubilee Campaign.
There have been a lot of killings, churches have been bombed, Christian women have been raped, people's properties have been confiscated, all sorts of things have taken place. It's one of the reasons why 100,000 Coptic Christians have fled the country.
We don't actually know the exact numbers. In my local church here in Fairfax, we've definitely seen a serious wave of Coptic immigration from Egypt since the revolution. And that's in one church in the U.S.
Armenian pastor Robert Zare Tashijan says some of his Cairo church members fled for the United States. That's not just Christians who are leaving.
I have Islam friends, they leave the country and go. They don't feel safe with the coming area with the Muslim Brotherhood.
Many Egyptians remain because they cannot afford to go anywhere else. Tadros is concerned about a Christian brain and wealth drain.
In the sense of the better educated, the more well off, the people that are the job creators, the ones that give the higher donations to the church as an institution, those guys will be the ones that will be leaving.
And that may mean less opportunity and help for needy Egyptian Christians. Lord Alton says American and Western aid to Egypt should be stopped unless the government upholds religious liberties.
We need to be insisting that this becomes a key question for Western governments. And so far, the evidence is not very encouraging.
Still, many Christians like these attending services at Cairo's Cave Church say they'll stay in Egypt. Father Simon Ibrahim says his church members are focused on God's promises.
He cares for us and will not forsake us. We believe in God's plan for Egypt and will follow it instead of any human plan.
And the rise of the Islamists and increased persecution is actually bringing Egyptian Christians closer together.
It's more unity than before in all the churches. They're doing a lot of prayer nights, meetings, talking about the future, giving hope for the people that God is in control.
Events like this one in the desert north of Cairo attracted more than 50,000 Egyptian Christians for 4 days of worship and prayer.
American Christians are very concerned about their brothers and sisters in Christ here in Egypt. What should they do?
We definitely need your prayers. The Lord tells us to pray for one another. You pray for us, and we will pray for you.
You can look at Coptic history with a sense of sadness at a continuous decline. But you can also look at it in the sense of how the hand of God has protected his people and made them survive through everything that they have been through.
Gary Lane, CBN News, Cairo.
Thanks, Gary. A radical Muslim group in Nigeria killed about 800 people this year. The Al-Qaeda-linked fighters have declared war on Nigeria's Christians, carrying out multiple attacks on Christian homes and churches, including a devastating car bomb on Christmas Day 1 year ago. As George Thomas reports, there have been calls for revenge, but also forgiveness.
It was a beautiful day. We came to church to celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ. People started coming as early as 6 in the morning. It was going to be a joyous occasion.
But it never turned out that way. A suicide bomber in a vehicle packed with explosives drove up this busy street and stopped in front of the church. Uche Bonaventure and his 17-month-old son had just walked out the church front doors when the bomb exploded.
The explosion threw me back and my son was hurled across the other side. Around me, I could see bodies on fire.
Within minutes, husbands became widowers, wives became widows, children became orphans, and parents were childless.
The suicide bomber knew precisely when to strike. It was shortly after 8 o'clock that Christmas morning, as one service was just concluding and the next one was about to begin.
26 of the 44 people who died that day attended St. Teresa's Church.
The people who carried out this attack are under the influence of the devil. They have only evil in their heart and they want to divide us.
The radical Muslim group Boko Haram claimed responsibility for this and several more attacks in other parts of Nigeria that Christmas Day. Boko Haram's goal is to turn Africa's most populous nation into an Islamic country.
I am very angry at them. We didn't do anything to deserve this, but if they are trying to get me to respond out of anger, I will not.
He and his son spent several weeks in the hospital recovering from third-degree burns. Today, you'll find him and his family praying for their attackers.
I want God to touch their hearts so that they will know that what they are doing is not good.
A sentiment echoed in Father Achi's sermons about the importance of forgiveness.
I have personally forgiven them, but what I need from Boko Haram is that they should repent and stop doing this evil work and confess.
That, however, isn't likely to happen anytime soon. 200 miles north of St. Teresa's Church, Esther Garba.
So many people love my husband. He loved to share the gospel with others.
Isaac Kuri.
They would not let me see my father's body. He was beyond recognition.
Margaret Frames.
He was shot in the mouth, in the elbow, and in the back.
And Salamatu Joshua.
I am asking God to bring peace to our city.
A blanketing northern Nigeria's most important city of Kano with prayer. On January 20th, 26 days after the Christmas Day massacre, Boko Haram killed 185 people in a string of coordinated attacks in Kano. It was the group's deadliest strike to date. Among the dead were the loved ones of these Christian families.
I can't do anything to bring my husband back. All I can do is trust in God. The Bible says we should love our enemies and pray for them.
A Boko Haram spokesman has declared war on Nigeria's government, the security services, and the country's Christians. In a video released online, he says, I enjoy killing anyone that God commands me to kill, the way I enjoy killing chickens and rams. Nigeria is evenly split between Christians in the south and Muslims in the north. Kano is overwhelmingly Muslim. Extremist groups routinely use this city and the surrounding areas as a base of operation.
It is very difficult to share the gospel here in the extreme northern parts of Nigeria.
Joshua works quietly as an evangelist in northern Nigeria. CBN News agreed to conceal his identity to protect him. He says the indigenous people consider Christians here as invaders and members of a Western religion.
I was born and raised here. I'm part of the North, yet because I'm a Christian, I am viewed and treated as a second, third, or fourth class citizen.
And now he fears Boko Haram is trying to spark a religious war by provoking Christians into attacking Muslims. Some Christian neighborhoods are taking measures to defend themselves. Others rely on God for protection and take comfort in His word.
Even when I walk through the dark valley of death, I will not be afraid, for you are close beside me.
George Thomas, CBN News, Kano, Nigeria.
Thank you, George. Up next, the Gracia Burnham story. I was there to mark the 10th anniversary of her rescue and the loss of her husband. She told me how she and her kids are still serving the Lord today. Stay tuned.
CWNews.org, your constant news source on the World Wide Web. Find daily updates on the global church. Watch the weekly broadcast.
Three former presidents come together to honor the life and ministry.
Also available in podcast. The in-depth insights into our reporter blogs.
Taliban kidnapped at least 18
in
South
Peru,
Korean
Christians.
Your online news source for complete coverage of the global church.
Today, many people are asking, what is the future for America? I believe God created this country to be an exceptional nation with a divine purpose. God has a plan, not only for the redemption of mankind, not only for the people of Israel, but for the United States of America.
Get Pat Robertson's newest DVD teaching, God's Plan for America, How to Prepare for the Days Ahead. In it, you'll discover how America is built on a Christian foundation, how America became the greatest country on earth, and what we can do to see the favor of God bless our land.
There is still an opportunity to enter into a period of unprecedented prosperity and national blessing if we will grasp hold of the plan God has for each one of us.
Pat Robertson's God's Plan for America. It's our gift to you when you join the 700 Club. Available now.
It began in a prayer meeting where a covenant was made and grew into the most powerful and prosperous nation the world has ever known. But has America broken its covenant with God? Can that covenant be renewed? Does God still have a plan for America?
In 2012, Gracia Berna marked 10 years since the end of her captivity at the hands of Muslim rebels in the Philippines. It was also the anniversary of her husband Martin's death, who was killed in that rescue. Earlier this year, I talked with Gracia about her experience and how she's been reaching out to her former captors.
The couple had been celebrating their 18th wedding anniversary at a resort in Palawan when terrorists kidnapped them and more than a dozen others.
Right now, we're passing by the area of Basilan Island, where the Abu Sayyaf first brought Martin and Gracia Burnham when they were kidnapped back in 2001. They spent just over a year in these jungles, constantly on the run, never knowing where their next meal was coming from, and completely dependent upon God for their daily survival.
We asked God for everything we needed. If we needed a drink of water, I asked God for a drink of water. And if we came to a stream, I drank the water. It didn't matter that it was dirty. It was water, and God had provided it for us.
What do you remember most about that day?
I remember that we hadn't eaten for, we were going on our 10th day. I didn't know you could live for 10 days without food, but we had salt and we had water. We would eat little leaves that from certain plants that we would pass by. So we were weak and exhausted. I told Martin, I don't know how much longer I can do this. I always said that to him. And he said, you know, Gracia, I think we're gonna get out of here. I just don't know when.
About noon on June 7th, 2002, shots rang out as the Philippine military attempted to rescue Martin and Gracia from their year-long captivity.
I immediately was shot in the leg before we could even get to the ground, and I kind of slid down the hill and came to rest beside Martin, and he was bleeding from his chest. And they saw I was alive and came and started dragging me up the hill, and I looked back at Martin and he was white. And that's when I knew he was dead. And they kind of bandaged me up at the top of the hill and called a helicopter. Mm-hmm. And it came and lifted me right out of there. Yeah.
Before their year in captivity, Martin was a busy pilot for New Tribes Mission, while Gracia supported him and helped raise their three children in the Philippines.
The best pilot that I've ever seen.
Martin often flew Dr. Alan Melichor to remote villages.
To me, Martin and Grisha reflect the persona of Christ. And so when they were adopted, I said, Lord, why them? Why Martin and Grisha? And then say, oh, why not them? Because I think the people that adopted them had really seen what Christians ought to be.
Grisha, the Abu Sayyaf took so much from you, your husband, a year of your life. How do you find forgiveness?
I think God came and did something in my heart, and I asked him, would you build forgiveness in my life? Would you help me start to love these guys? And he did it.
Today, several Abu Sayyaf members have come to know the Lord because Grisha chose to forgive and began the Martin and Grisha Burnham Foundation to help reach Muslims in the Philippines.
Some of the very guys that held us hostage got a hold of some of those things we had printed, and it impacted their lives. And God somehow used it, and so far, four of them have come to know the Lord.
Grisha also wrote the New York Times bestseller, In the Presence of My Enemies, and a follow-up to Fly Again. She's also a much sought-after speaker whose story of God's grace under trial resonates with everyone.
And they just want to hug me and say, we prayed for you. And I never get tired of hearing that.
Today, Grisha's youngest son, Zach, studies music at Calvary Bible School in Kansas City, the same school where his parents met and married. Oldest son, Jeff, is a missionary pilot just like his dad, serving in Africa. And daughter Mindy married a new tribe's missionary, just like Grisha.
I'm a grandma, twice, yay. And the children are grown and they're fine and they love the Lord. So the rest of what happens to me is just icing on the cake.
Grisha says, just like the title of her second book, she is learning to fly again.
It would be awful if I had gone through this horrible thing and come out on the other end thinking I had anything to do with it. So if I'm flying today, it's because of God's goodness in my life.
It's one of the greatest privileges of my life was covering that story and meeting Grisha and her family. And if you haven't read her book yet, In the Presence of My Enemies, I couldn't put it down. I highly recommend it. And to learn more about her ministry, you can visit the Martin and Grisha Burnham Foundation website. Find the link at cbnnews.com. And coming up, he's one of the world's greatest boxers. Now he's fighting the good fight of faith. Hear Lucille Talusan's conversation with Manny Pacquiao.
Hi, this is Pat Robertson. This is an important time in the history of America. It's an important time in the history of CBN. And what you do is so very important now. But we've got to get the gospel out here in America. We've got to help the poor and the needy, feed those who are hungry, clothe those who are naked, bring medical attention to those who are suffering, and more than anything, bring hope to those who are without hope throughout the world. So your 700 Club membership makes a huge difference. And I ask you to go to your phone and call. If you haven't already called in, we appreciate what you've done so much. So don't slack. We don't want our hands to be empty. We want to say, Lord, here are those who have come to you because of my labors. Telephones are available, toll-free line, and we just thank God for each one of you. So don't hesitate to call and do it now.
When you give, smiles grow bigger. When you care, homes are happier. When you comfort, the hurt goes away. When we all come together to love, miracles happen.
Christian World News, your window to the global church. For stories of revival.
Another revival.
Persecution.
Funeral, relatives and fellow Christians mourn him.
First country over the international dateline.
I'm George Thomas in Baghdad, and coming up on the broadcast, an exclusive interview.
And the impact of Christian leaders. Watch Christian World News.
Champion boxer Manny Pacquiao became the latest athlete to use his fame to share his faith. Lucille Talusan has his story.
Seven-time champion of the world.
The Boxing Writers Association of America named him Fighter of the Decade. In his 17-year career, Manny Pac-Man Pacquiao fought his way to the top, becoming the first eight-division boxing champ of the world. But fame and fortune did not come easy for Pacquiao. His parents separated when he was in elementary school. Extreme poverty forced him to leave home and find a job in Manila at age 13 to support his family.
For a time, Manny lived on the streets. He sold flowers and worked in construction sites just to survive. But his difficult life dramatically changed when he managed to be on the Philippine National Amateur Boxing Team.
The rest is history. The world witnessed Pacquiao conquer every opponent in the boxing ring. But as his boxing career soared, he succumbed to the temptations of the world that pounded heavily on him.
Monday to Saturday,
I went to church on Sunday, but from Monday to Saturday, I was in the bar drinking. I was gambling. Careless words came out of my mouth. I committed adultery. I didn't care.
Manny says he felt the guilt of his sins when he began reading the Word of God. He also remembered hearing the voice of God in a dream several years before.
I remember that night when I received a letter from my mother saying that my sister stopped going to school because I was not sending them the money. I cried, blaming myself for spending all the money on alcohol. On that night, I heard the voice of God in my dream. His voice was 10 times louder than thunder. And he said to me, my child, why have you gone astray? I forgot about that dream, but when I started reading the Bible, the first verse I read said that God talked to man through dreams. And so I realized, wow, my dream was real.
Since then, Manny became hungry for the Word of God, leading to a deep personal relationship with Jesus Christ. Now he has Bible study every day, memorizing verses by heart, because he says the Word of God is his weapon against temptation.
Keep this book of the law always in your lips. Meditate on it day and night so that you may be careful to do everything written in it. Then you will be prosperous and successful. So when you meditate the words and you keep the words of God in your mouth, in your lips, in your heart, in your mind, you will be guided. You will, the Holy Spirit will guide you.
Manny believes Jesus is coming soon. He grabs every opportunity to spread the gospel because he believes that God uses him and other famous Christian athletes like Tim Tebow and Jeremy Lin to draw people to God.
This is the time, the right time now to spread his words. People idolizing us, and then whatever the words come out of our mouth, they will listen, they will believe.
Pastor Jeric Soriano is Pacquiao's spiritual mentor.
These men, Tim Tebow, Jeremy Lin, and Manny Pacquiao, these are God's billboards for the world to watch, the world to hear, the world to see. And basically, what's the message? God is saying, you like what's happening in their lives? They're honoring God and what they're doing? Fine. But what about you? You know, I really believe we're in the last days, and God is using these world champions to reach out to the lost.
This, he says, will help him win his ultimate fight, to conquer evil and glorify God in his life.
In Matthew 10, verse 22, you will be hated by everyone because of me, but the one who stands firm to the end will be saved. When you accept Jesus Christ in your life as your Lord and Savior, you have eternal life. And you obey, obey His commandments.
Lucille Talusan, CBN News, Manila, Philippines.
CBNNews.com. News you want, when you want, 24/7. Stay current with up-to-the-minute stories.
Ephraim Graham, CBN News, New York.
I don't have to wait for my news anymore.
CBNNews.com, at your fingertips all day long.
I only watch the stories I want to see.
I find the story, I click on it, and boom, I'm there.
Embassy in Washington, Eric Stackelbeck, CBN News.
The source for your news, CBNNews.com.
Come on, give me that. Bye. Sure, life is busy, but I found a way to make a huge difference in people's lives. I guess you could say I'm changing the world right here from home. I bring medical supplies and doctors to people in need. and dig wells so that villagers can have clean and safe water to drink. I make it possible to preach the gospel in over 100 countries, including right here in America. And when disaster strikes, I'm there, providing food, thank you, and emergency supplies to give people hope again. Every day, CBN and I are making the world a better place.
Here you go.
My life is hectic, so I join CBN through Pledge Express. My bank does all the work, and I know that my gift is being used where it's needed most. So become a CBN partner and join Pledge Express, because you can do a world of good right from where you are. Hi, good morning. Are you ready to get started?
When you care, souls are set free. When you give, lives are made new. When you share, eternal life begins. When we all come together to love, miracles happen.
Finally, today, in our opinion, the best story of 2012. An Iranian court released imprisoned pastor Yusuf Nardakhani from prison. He'd been facing a death sentence for the crime of apostasy. Here's Ephraim Graham.
This is the scene Christians around the world have been praying to see. Pastor Yusuf Nardakhani, alive, free, and embraced in the bosom of his family. It's a miracle 3 years in the making. An Iranian court sentenced Yusuf to death for the crime of leaving Islam to become a Christian. He was given several chances to recant his Christian faith in exchange for his freedom. He refused every time. When asked to repent by the judges, Yusuf stated, "Repent means to return. What should I return to? To the blasphemy that I had before my faith in Christ?" The judges replied, "To the religion of your ancestors, Islam." Yusuf replied, "I cannot." The American Center for Law and Justice has been closely involved in efforts to release Pastor Nardakhani and kept the case in the spotlight with a Twitter campaign that reached more than 3 million people a day. An international outcry put pressure on the Iranian regime. The judge acquitted him of apostasy, but convicted Yusuf of evangelizing Muslims and sentenced him to time already served. Yusuf is now free, but he's still in great danger. Karl Moeller, former president of Open Doors USA, told CBN News earlier this year he may be more at risk after he's released.
In fact, what we've seen in numerous cases over the last 30 years in Iran is someone may be judicially acquitted or released on a technicality, but then their lives are deeply also under threat. They can simply disappear, or they can be tortured and arrested without any judicial process. So by no means is Pastor Yusuf's situation free and clear, even if he is acquitted of these charges.
Ephraim Graham, CBN News.
Wow, what a story. Thanks to you and a lot of prayer. That was a miracle. Well, that's all for this special edition of the Best Stories of 2012. Join us next week for a brand new year of Christian World News. Until then, goodbye and God bless you.